Hi, welcome to ToddFun.com, and today it's back to the grandfather's clock. I have a video of when I got this clock, the case I have too. I'll put a link in the show notes so you can go watch a video on how I fully cleaned the cabinet and waxed it and went over the clock and its history. But this is about the mechanism. I'm going to show you my test rig as well as a little problem I'm having. I'm also going to queue you up on a couple of videos I got in the can and I'm working on that will be for the general public, not just for my subscribers. This is kind of more for my subscribers. The video on how to clean a grandfather clock mechanism and how to oil a grandfather clock mechanism, that's going to be just for, I'm going to put it up to my Todd Fund site, but my general viewers might not like that much detail, but people looking for that information would probably enjoy it. So let's take a look closer at this and what I'm having a little problem with so I can get this quick video up for my general subscribers. Go handhold here, I think. I've got it on a test jig because normally it bolts inside of the cabinet. And this is just, I welded up two Z brackets, L brackets, and made a big Z out of it. One on each side. That bolts to the bottom of the clock like it in the same spot as it would in the cabinet. And then everything can hang over the edge away from the table. It has the tubular gongs, the pendulum, and the weights. And they all, of course, hook up to the clock. Now, this is an early 1970s clock. I originally thought it was a Hermel, H-E-R-M-L-E, but that is not what this mechanism is. Through further research and digging around, I thought that because that's what Howard Millard usually sells, is Hermule. German-made clock either way, but this mechanism in here is a Urgo, U-R-G-O, I guess I pronounced that, Urgo. And it's very, very, very similar to, I mean, the mechanisms are almost indistinguishable, and certainly all the service and maintenance is very similar. So what is the problem? I got it in the test rig so that I could set up and set the swing. That has to have the period just perfect. I'll cover that in a video on how to set the swing of a pendulum as well as how to adjust the time. It's not that complicated, but that can be a separate video. That's why it's here. And that's so I could also make sure it's properly oiled. And any mechanical problems I can deal with right here in this nice little test jig. Once it's all done in here, of course, it'll go back in the grandfather's clock in the dining or in the grand room, well, whatever room. This clock, it just has the weights. One weight is for the gong, and this weight is for the time, and this weight is for the chimes, essentially the quarter hour Westminster chiming. And it doesn't have any dates, but it does have moon phase. And so it keeps a really good time. In the oiling video, you'll see where I found some issues, but I'm going to be able to get around them. Now, to actually have a clock like this that's 40 years old serviced could cost you anywhere from $1,500, or you could almost buy a new one. This particular mechanism is about $1,500, brand new still today. They still sell it. But what's the problem I'm having? Well, the interesting problem is the gongs. When I got it all working, I was like, wait a minute, that doesn't sound right. Are some of these gongs out of tune? Are these tubular chimes out of tune? And nope, they're not. I'm going to see if I can make the camera see something that I can't. Let me see it. Okay, so if I can show you, like one of these, if I can try. Okay, there, you see that pad right there? There's little leather pads on these. These are the hammers. And there's leather pads right here. And that's what hits the gong. But if you can come over here, look at that's all black. And it's really hard, and I tried to clean it, but it's super hard. So now listen to this. I wonder if I can... Oh, I could film it properly. So kind of listen to them. Hopefully it comes out okay. But this one's not, this leather's not too hard. And this one's not too bad, hardness-wise. Okay, but now this one that has the hard leather, listen to this. Now, I don't know if you can tell, but that's really tingy, kind of really high frequency harmonics because the leather's so hard. And then the rest don't sound so bad either. And to test that theory, I got some pencils. The white one has got a hard rubber, it kind of got hard from sitting in the garage, and then the regular, I don't know, pinkish one is soft. So now let's listen to the pinky soft one on that same bar. And now we'll do the hard one. And so it's fairly clear that having a hard hammer causes a high frequency kind of resonance or, you know, vibrations in the pipe. And so I have to replace those leathers. So that's kind of challenging. These aren't real normal. These are more of the rare hammers. There's lots of hammer repairs and stuff. Oops, we're gonna get 9 o'clock. Well, there you go, it's 9 o'clock. I didn't know that was coming up. But yeah, it's a challenging one to come up with some ideas here. I've contacted some clock companies that sell parts, and most of them say, oh, go get these leather inserts, but they're for a different type of hammer. They're for the type where you screw the leather pad, the leather nibs off and put them in the hammerheads. These aren't them. So let's take them off, take a look at them. And I had one company reply and say, hey, you know, just glue in some inserts, but oh, it doesn't look like you can do that either. So we'll look at it and see. To the bench. I figured I better show my viewers a little bit about disassembling it because they like the mechanics. So you take off the two hands, and that's real easy. It's just a screw you take off, and then they pull off, and they're easy enough to reset. And then the face that has a little bit of mechanics on it because of the moon dial, there's these clips. Now, if I could show it to you. Well, you can see this one down here. See this little clip right here? It's already off. It clips onto this stud, and there's one in each corner. And so when you reach in, you can, like when I flip this on both sides, all four corners will be really free, and then the face plate will just literally come away. So see if you can watch that. I'll have to do it blind. So that one's unclipped, and there's one on one left. On this side. There we go. And then that just pulls away, and you're left with the mechanism. Now it's only running because I knocked something. I knocked over my chimes because I actually had already started taking off the chimes here. This is that holds the chime tubes, and it just literally goes on four studs, and then the tubes hang from strings off of these the tubular chimes, and then bolted onto that on the backside is the hammers. Boy, I'm doing terrible. I'm apologizing for this. Not well thought through, but then all the hammers are hooked onto strings here, so you just have to unhook the string and then pull it through, and then you see that string comes loose. And it's just a way for you to tighten and tension. You turn this little knob right here, and that lets you tighten the tension so you can get exactly an eighth of a millimeter between your hammerhead and the chime. And so that's just a little nut adjustment for that. So I'll have to pop off all of these, pull all the strings through. Super easy to adjust, super easy. And then, if we come out like this, and I come back this way, you can see that there's just a couple of studs that it pulls off of, and then out come your hammers. And that's what we want to be interested at the bench. We want to look at, hope I'm not making you guys sick. We want to look at these guys. And you can see the one that makes the really bad noise. They all a little bit. This one's a little scuffed up too. And it's just on some spring steel. I can buy the spring steel still, but I can't find these hammerheads. In fact, I can find the heads, but without the leather. I can find them with the metal inserts. Or if they have, well, they're just different, I guess, for a different machine. Maybe for a bell or something. I did think of using some baseball glove conditioner, and I did soak them for a few days, thinking, hey, maybe some leather conditioner would help. And it didn't. This one was black when I got it. And the other ones, it didn't change them at all. So the leather conditioning just didn't help. So let's take a look if what we can do to either dig those out and re-glue new nibs in there, or what, because I can't really find to order these. And one person did say, yeah, just glue in, go to a shoe store and get some leather and glue it in. I was like, okay, maybe I can do that. Well, we can take a quick look at this, more stuff is off. So this Z bracket is just welded up, angle iron and tubing. And for the most part, I can bend it into the shape I need. If not, I can shim it before I bolt it to the table here. And it's important to have it perfectly level on both sides and in the front, because that's the way it's going to be. It's going to be level when you have it in your clock housing. You're going to want it nice and level. So let's just take a look at a few more things. You can kind of see these hammers here. This is sort of the music box drum that has these little pins on it, and as the pins come around, it pulls on these hammers, and these hammers then pull on strings, and then the strings will let the hammer gong hit the tubular gong. And there's four of these for the Westminster, and then one of these for the hourly. And the hourly runs on a separate chain and weight, and this runs on this is the very far left weight and chain, this is the very far right weight and chain. And then the clock works is the middle chain. And it's ticking away right now. Whoops, there you can see the governor kick in. It's playing the song. And that spinning governor is sort of like a little paddle wheel that as it spins, it paddles the air and spins at a very specific rate. And if it starts, because it's basically air resistance, right? But if it gets going too fast, then if you take a look, it will open up. See how it opens? I don't know if you can see that. It spreads, and that makes it essentially run slower. And if it's running too fast, it'll spread and run slower and paddle with the air. And that makes sure that this drum spins at a proper rate so that the chime is in tempo, or it's in the right rhythm. You know, it doesn't like go too slow and go too fast. Likewise, there's another governor over here, but that's for the hammer, so the hammer pounds evenly as it goes hour to hour. So those are interesting mechanisms. Back here, this is the turn the clock. This is the pendulum, and inside there's an escapement. I turned off the camera. So there's an escapement in there, and you can see there's the pendulum ticking and the escapement going back and forth. I'll cover that more maybe in some other detail. But this is the main spring, the main suspension spring. It's very delicate, but it's sort of like a spring that lets everything hang, the pendulum hang. Then this is the crutch, sometimes called the verg, and that's where the pendulum hangs from. And there's the crutch pin that goes and kind of kicks the pendulum back and forth. And that little round thing in front is the verg adjust, and you can turn it, and that controls the center point of this crutch pin. Well, you can see there's a little spring mechanism right there, that little tri-shaped spring, and I can move that, and that changes the center point of this, and that controls the tick and tock motion of it. Let's look at the other side, but that's an important adjustment when we get to timing it. And here's a front view of the clutch, essentially, because you can turn it and you see how it turned it off center now. So if for some reason it needed that in order to swing up an even tick to an even tock, that's how you do that, as opposed to trying to bend that rod. And then of course the pendulum has to be adjusted in length, the bob on the pendulum, which is now missing, but that adjusts in length to get the exact number of beats per hour. If you get it exactly right, the clock won't lose any time during the week. On the front mechanisms, it looks kind of convoluted, but everything's kind of got its home. The main thing here is for the minute hand, right behind that is the main shaft for the hour. They turn independent of each other through some sprockets back here. This gear out here is to do the moon phases, because when you put the face on, there's a gear that engages this gear for doing the moon phases. That turns, you know, really slowly through the other gears that are on the moon phase. Right behind that is the snail gear, and that controls what hour you're on as far as gonging is concerned. This farthest one out is a 1 hour, so it'll gong once. If it's here, it'll gong twice. Here, it'll gong three times, all the way around to the merry center, which it gongs 12 times. That's called it looks like a snail, and that's where this silver one will rest. The silver one goes over here and connects to this. And interestingly enough, if this has got one tooth engaged, it'll gong once. If it's got two teeth engaged, it'll gong twice. So this mechanism of the snail gear controls how many of these teeth engage. So if we engage, say, two teeth, we'll go gong once and gong twice. So there. And that, of course, will control whether or not, if it's all the way over here, it'll engage 12 of these teeth. So that controls the hourly mechanisms. Then some escapement here in order to control whether you want it to be silent or not, or when the actual quarter hours kick off. There's some sprocket cogs in there that will kick this up every quarter hour to let this guy start running. And what this is this cam. If that pin is over here, you can see it's a very short distance from this pin to this pin. So it'll run this cylinder for a very short time, from here to here. But when it goes from this sprocket to this sprocket, it runs a little longer, so that's a half hour. From this sprocket to this sprocket, it's a quarter hour, and this longest sprocket cam position is to do the full hour Westminster chime, or roll this for the full Westminster chime cycle. And then when it lands in here, then it'll kick in the snail gear, which kicks in the hour gongs. The rest of the stuff inside is just controlling the hours and the minutes for the day. We could probably, sometimes it'll kick over if you lift this, and it started it, and now when we drop this, it's gonna play the half hour. And so now you can see it's running, and the drum is turning, and the sprocket goes, and it stops when it gets to that spot, and that's be the end of playing the half hour chime. So really simple, comes apart real easy. We have to oil a lot of stuff, but I'll cover that in the oiling, and you have to make sure none of these pivot points are wobbled out, and if so, you got to resleeve them, but we'll cover all that in another video. Let's go over and take a look at the leather, because once I get the leather fixed, I can start using this clock, because the other stuff is already done. Well, it's pretty obvious which one's got the hardest leather. That's that dark one. But I got to get these out, and it looks like they might come off. I'll at least try and take them off. If not, I'm just going to dig out the leather and glue in new. That unscrewed easy enough. Oh, wow, check that out. Yeah, see, that's what they show online. They show that. They don't show that soft leather. I did find one aftermarket producer of clock parts called Time Savers, and they're not sure they have this, but they had something in their inventory. It was $6, so I just said, yeah, go ahead, order it. And it sounds like it's this, but they don't know. It's just a description. And so if that comes in and if those are really them, then we'll show that too. So noticing a very slight seam here, I thought maybe these would pull apart, so I risked clamping this up in the vise, and then it just started turning, thinking maybe a twist, but it actually is just a press fit. This are two metal pieces, and they're milled out to produce sort of a leather stamp. And you can see a little piece of residue right here. This is a little piece of the, it must have went in a little crooked during the creation, and that's a little nip of leather that was stuck inside this shell, and that's probably from that little missing lip right there. It nipped off, it cut, it essentially tore. So they must start with a little disc of leather, and then they stick it on there, and then they must just do a press fit on. So that's very interesting. If I clean that up, now I'd have to get the right size. So this would be too big. And you'd have to get the right thickness too. But it's possible that if I experiment with the size of the little leather, and I think I can just press them right on and have new leather tops. Just as quick as that. Huh. Just a matter of getting them apart, I guess. Let me make some of those and see what happens. Boy, I bet you some of the people watching this video were screaming at me for not noticing that, and they probably saw it when they saw that slate. I just thought that was sort of a rembling. It was so tight, I thought it was just sort of a... I thought they machined this all out of one chunk and then just tapped it. I didn't even think they had to put a collar on, but boy, that sure works out nice. I just trace out and cut a little bit larger circle, put it in the vise with a socket, and then just push it on, and it just clamps down tight. I'm sure that what I ordered now from that company is just leather discs. They just pre-stamp them, so I'm looking at doing this anyway with what they send me. But they might send me a slightly different type of leather, so I'll go ahead and finish these, and I'll bet if the leather's the same thickness as this and they sound good, I'll just leave them, because that's what I was probably supposed to do in the first place. Now, interestingly enough, when I took them apart and cleaned them, they all had residue of new leather down in here, except for the one that was causing all the noise. This one only had residue from its original head, which was the thin one that was making... So apparently someone went in and replaced four of them and didn't replace the one that was black, which was making the horrible noise. Because when I took this apart, it didn't have any residue of old leather. It just had the residue of the single piece of leather, whereas these had like a red leather in them all. The previous tips. But I cleaned them all up now, so we'll put this on. So I cut the leather pads so they just fit inside. So basically, if you cut it the same diameter as this, you'd be just fine. I cut mine just a smidgen smaller than that disc, and that way when they press, they'll press up in there. There you go, all assembled again. Nice, fresh, soft leather. Let's assemble it, and hear a couple chimes. Well, it's all put back together. It's ticking along. I didn't put the face plate on because it doesn't really need it for this test. We're just trying to see if the gong sound pretty good, right? So let's get in and take a closer view of this. So originally, this one sounded pretty good. Let's test it again. Oh yeah, that sounds even better than it did before. This one was always okay. Yeah, that even sounds better. Now this is the culprit one right here. Oh yeah, that sounds really good. Let's hear it a little bit heavier. Oh, sweet, very sweet. And I suppose they're all good. Yeah. And the hourly. Yeah. That one might have been a little tingy, but not too bad. It is supposed to be a longer pipe. So let's hear it run and see what it sounds like. Oh wow, that sounded sweet. They had that nice tone that just makes them sound like they're kind of echoing. Nothing sharp about them this time at all. That leather really made a difference on that. I can adjust how hard they hit, essentially by their spacing with these little standoff screws, as well as there's a little bit of a pivot point back here on each of the spring steel arms I can adjust. So I can control how kind of it's loudness, if you will. So I'll probably tinker with that some too. But that's it. That's a fix on the hammers. Those hammers are good now. So I can go into the next four parts. There's going to be a four-part video coming up. I was going to be taking this over to the bench, just the mechanism, and looking at all the pivot points and deciding how wore it is. Because if the pivot points get wobbled out, this clock won't keep good time. Now it's currently keeping really good time. I had it run for several days. It didn't lose any time. Yet I do know that I have a bad pivot point because I did shoot some of that video already. I'm not going to fix it this time because it's not wore to the point where it's causing a problem,
But in 2 years from now, when I tear it down again for its 2 year cleaning, I'm going to probably go into it. I'll have the tools then to properly drill and rebush that pivot point, maybe another one. So maybe in 2 years you'll see that video. It can be done by yourself. If you take it to a clock service center, they're going to tear it down and clean it and rebush it for the price of the product. So if you're going there, just put this one in the trash and buy another movement, because it's just too expensive. Anything made after 1960s, you can still get them. So just buy new, you know. But if you want to dive into fixing them, that's what I'm going to be doing probably in a couple years from now. There's a lot to do at Todd Fun, so it'll be a couple years before I get back to rebushing. But we'll see them in the first video. The second video is how to clean it. Well, we got some clock cleaning solution. We're going to do the dip it in the bath, maybe oscillate it a lot. I don't have an ultrasonic cleaner, but I can simulate that a little bit, plus some pressure washer. I got some ideas. We'll see it in video two. Part two, and we'll get this mechanism clean because there's tarry, gooky, old 30, 40 year old oil inside those pivot points. And what it's doing, even though you re-lubricate it, you're going to just grind away those pivot points. So you got to get that gook out. And we'll cover different ways of doing it. We'll cover a super simple short way if you're really not into this. We'll do the dip way, which is what I'm going to do. We're going to cover, we'll talk about the ultrasonic cleaning and tearing it apart to clean it. You can tear it apart and clean it too. That's another way. We'll talk about all those things in part two for cleaning your clock and getting it all back together again. Part three is going to be oiling it. Now, when you oil a clock, you have to use, I recommend using the 100% synthetic oil, just a little bit. We'll cover that in part three. I've shot some of that video too, and then grease it. You got to have really good grease. Now, what makes this grease better than the white lithium grease I already have on it? Well, the white lithium grease, you might be risking it reacting with the brass, and you want this to look nice. And you're also, we want it to look good, because when sometimes the clocks, you can see inside of them because they're glass encased, and you don't want to see, grease and gooky white blobs. And this is sort of a clear grease that stays in place on just a few spots that you need grease. So we'll cover that in part three. And part four is going to be setting the beat on the clock so that it has proper beat. You don't want your clock out of beat. That can cause it to stop and cause other problems. We'll also adjust its timing so that it will have a proper adjustment and how to get the exact number of beats per hour. If you get the clock adjusted to the right number of beats per hour, it won't lose time. And then, just the setup, essentially that, get your clock set up, anything you have to set, setting the moon dial, setting the timing, getting it level, that'll be video four, and then, essentially seeing it in the cabinet when it's done. And so that's coming up, stay tuned for those. Thumbs up if you enjoyed this little investigation and solution. It's not all my viewers are great on clocks, but hey, I do a little of everything, so I throw a little everything up there. So sign up, subscribe if you like a little of everything, and join me at Todd Fun again next time.